So it's 12:20, my clock tells me that. Welcome everyone to my talk. I'm happy and kind of surprised that so many people showed up here listening to a talk from technology of the 1980s. I think these Gregorian monk music was quite fitting. They were kind of like we're the conspiracy crowd here or something like that. Okay, so as you can feel from my title, Ice Crazy is damn old, but it's still around and it will be for a while. And I wanted to talk a little bit about what's going on in the Ice Crazy world, what's up in the 21st century. And I have four parts. When I submitted the talk, I was aiming to get my regular 45 minute slot, so now I have 30. So I'm not Stephen Rosted, but I go more to that direction. So I can't go to that detail I originally planned to, but still I want to mention those four things. One is the workflow thing, it's about the Ice Crazy subsystem, what happened in the past years and what consequences does it have, because I think it's useful for you as developers to know that. And then I want to show one complex setups I am personally facing these days to see what weird things of I2C setups you can have and what the consequences of are and what we will be dealing with in the near future. Coming from that are already some API changes I want to introduce to you and to make sure this work and other crazy stuff works. A few years ago, I introduced my fault injector framework for I2C, and this has some additions, and I think it's good if you know about them to have robust setups. So the workflow thing, it's nothing completely new. I talk about that for a while now, but I have to repeat it somehow. I2C, its simplicity is a problem because for a complex example, a GPU driver, there are huge teams working on it and they stay with it and they are there to keep things working, where I2C is super simple, hardware makers just create just another IP core and there's someone writing a driver it, they pass it to my subsystem and move on to develop the next driver, which is not I2C, but maybe SPI or something like that. So this is coined a term like fly-by or fly-through subsystem. It's very hard to have people who are consistently working on I2C. So lots of people coming by and working hard to get that driver upstream, and once it's upstream, if I'm more or less lucky, they're around to handle all of the bug fixes, which users may find later, but sometimes the people disappear completely, and then, the usual idea is that the maintainer takes over the maintainership even for those drivers, but I2C, the subsystem itself is largely maintained in my spare time, and there are two consequences of that, because my spare time is very limited. I can't handle all these drivers. And I was there. I was running in danger of a burnout. You really have to focus on the things you like to do. And I like to help people getting on speed with kernel development and all that. But reviewing the 121st driver, which is like following a basic pattern, this is not really fun to do. So this is where I have to do a little bit of pushback and saying, yes, I'm a maintainer, I'm a gatekeeper, but actually reviewing is a community effort. And this means community as individual people, but also I think companies should also engage more in reviewing other people patches, because we're getting so many patches that we have a scalability problem there. And to solve that, we need more people. And just to show that, so the left side of this graph is when I took over the I2C subsystem, and we back then already had 70 bus master drivers for I2C. For such a simple, ancient, not much changing bus already 70, but over the years we grew to more than 120, and there's no signs that this is like not further increasing. It's so simple that people say, oh yeah, well, we will do this custom controller for the GPU and need another driver. And I can tell you, even on hardware side, it's always the same mistakes happening, and then we had to have another quirk structure and what not. I would really suggest just focus on a few IP cores and we make sure that this thing works. But yeah, this is my dream. This is reality. But I think you can understand this is way too much for me to handle. So one response I got mainly last year was, hey, what about group maintainership? Just let go. Don't try to keep everything to yourself. But for me, it's a fly-by subsystem. There is not really a group where I can share the work with. So I think it's a different setup, and it became pretty visible when this year there was a period of 3 weeks when I was ill. And I really couldn't do I2C maintenance work. So I wrote this mail saying, I think it's annoying, no catastrophe, but it shows that I'm the single point of failure. And this is, of course, not a good thing to be. And I explicitly asked, I'm open to group maintainership. If you think you're a reliable candidate, please get in touch with me. I got one single response, Sebastian, thank you very much, because that made me feel like I'm not completely ignored, which was get well soon. So this is kind of funny, but it's also a bit like cynic, you know. So I would like, I can only repeat, I'm open to group maintainership, but which group? So what I did a while ago, and this is, I think, important to know, I divided my maintainership first into two parts. First, the I2C core, and then the I2C drivers. And as you can see from this excerpt from the maintainers file, I'm explicitly listed for the I2C subsystem for the core, and the status is maintained. And I'm not explicitly listed for the host drivers, and the status is set to odd fixes. This is very, very intentional. I'll be there if I catch some bug or there's something for some ancient driver. I try my very best, but it's really that. I try my very best to keep up with that, but what I really, really want, I want a maintainer for every driver. I think this is, from my flyby system perspective, this is the only thing I can see that will work, and I tried that. It works okay-ish so far. By chasing people, 66 drivers have a dedicated maintainer now, which is 50% if you do the math. And yeah, I'll try keep following that road and see what happens. Some maintainers are really responsive per driver. Some disappear again. That was kind of expected. But still, for me, as a subsystem maintainer, it took off some pressure, which made me prevent me from burning out. So I think in general it's a good move. It's not perfect, but I think it's the best we can do. I have a few companions. I want to mention them because they helped me really. This is because I'm not very familiar with ACP. I'm totally an embedded guy. So I thank Mika for stepping up, and also Andy, are you here? Okay, and there's also Andy and Jarko from Intel who assist him and to take this away from me, all this ACPI stuff. Peter Rosen is very good for I2C muxing and complicated setups, to getting the locking right. And Jean Delverme, who was previously maintaining the I2C subsystem, is still around for the PC hardware, which I'm not super familiar with. So thanks to those guys. I'm not completely alone, but still, I think I2C is under-maintained. And I also want to call out Renesas, which the company who is largely contracting me and who is really driving I2C development. I mean, you know, these days Linux can be an I2C slave, not only a master. and the upcoming changes, I will talk in a bit. It's really, it's largely to their funding that this exists in this day today. So on the one hand, I'm very thankful for them, but on the other hand, as you can see, it's also a single point of failure. If there's some management decisions to cut that, problem. So that's where we are from a subsystem point of view. Things are working okay-ish, but it's not ideal with this single point of failures thingy. And I'm the maintainer of the core, and I'm looking for driver maintainers. Also, when you send on a new driver, I will likely ask you if you want to be the maintainer. Otherwise, it will stay orphan or whatever. That's the best I came up with so far. Not entirely happy situation, but that's the way it is. Let's get more technical. It's not always like this, that you have this one master and some clients and they're talking to each other. Because I learned the term GMSL and it became a bit scary to me. This is a serial link which transfers mainly graphics data, either from a camera or to a display. And but it has, in this high bitrate stream, you can encapsulate I2C to that. And so here are all the other interfaces needed for that. Here's a regular I2C bus with some kind of deserializer, and it has four outputs where you can connect, in our case, cameras to it. And this is here the high-speed link, and there's I2C encapsulated, and then you have here the serializer reverting all this high-speed thingy, and after that you have plain I2C again. The thing is, so you see four channels there which can have cameras and have I2C. The thing is now the cameras have some I2C devices with their addresses, and they are all the same. So by definition, they are all the same, but you can reprogram them to another address at runtime. So they basically say, the hardware people said, we will let software sort out that problem, how to give them unique addresses. And this is something entirely new. We don't have support for that, we need that. And there are some more gory details, like, here on this camera side, there's also a small microcontroller who talks I2C to the other client, so we have a multi-master setup. And now add to that that for some reason, if you power up this device, all channels are open and not closed. So if you start the system and plug everything in, everyone is talking I2C to everyone with basically the same addresses, and it's a huge mess. And the first step we need to do is like, we need the I2C core to something like, hey, give me a dynamic address I can use to reprogram this client there. Which is not super easy because it's a non-probable bus. So the first idea was, hey, yeah, okay, let the user specify a range which is safe to use. But then we realized, okay, everything very high level, there are much more details to that. But then we found out, okay, this is pretty fragile, because if the setup is slightly different with another device using exactly this address you reserved for the pool, then it might happen you run out of addresses in the pool and the system won't work. So the next thing was we kind of enforce people to describe the buses fully and consider every not used address as available, which is kind of a paradigm shift, because currently, especially in device trees, you just describe the devices you know you need and let the other be undescribed. But I'm still not super happy with it, because with device tree we can do a lot of things, but then there's also ACPI, and then you have to rely on broken firmware and relying on them describing the buses fully so you can assume the other addresses are free to use. Ooh. it's getting dangerous again. So work needs to be done in that area. We are working on it. Luca is there. Luca is there. GMSL is not only the candidate who needs that. There's also a technology like FPD Link, which is basically the same, except that it's very different. Yes, it has a high-speed link and encapsulates I2C over that, but it's not here that the devices are reprogrammable, but here, in this guy, they have an address translation table you have to reprogram. So that technically, on this side, the devices here have another address than they have there. And despite all this being very confusing, it also means that the time when you need a dynamically assigned address is different from our case. Because in our case, when we want to reprogram that, we need it at device probe time. When this guy wants to reprogram the FPD link case, if this guy wants to reprogram the address table, it needs it much earlier, at device creation time. Don't need to understand that fully. It's just showing you that people are, oh, and FPD link is hot pluggable. Awesome, because I2C is so designed to be hot pluggable. Yeah, so this is what Linux in the 21st century is kind of looking like. People are using it because they know it and there's technology available around it. Yeah, but they get very creative how to use it, and there are clearly cases Linux is not prepared for yet, and we are working on that step by step. It's a bit painful, as you probably can guess. Oh, by the way, that was only half the truth. The setup is much more complex because we have two of them. And if you, as I told you, by power up, they have all the gates open. Now I have two of them are having all the gates open, so there's much more communication. And you have to ensure that both have first their gates closed before you can do anything one by one. So you have to hear potential race conditions, or you have to make sure both are handled already. So not much fun. So we're starting slowly with API changes. The first thing is that we now usually, if you declare a new I2C device or a new dummy device, whatever, they return a null pointer if something goes wrong. But if we want to go into the direction of dynamically assigned addresses, we need to make a difference. We need to know, does it fail because the address is already busy or if there's no memory? Kind of obvious. But that means that all these I2C new functions need to be converted from returning null to returning an error pointer. And of course, doing this in the I2C core is pretty easy, but I have to convert each and every driver and make sure it still works and do some mass conversion things. And this is where I'm currently working on. Of course, I use Coccinelle to do the main work with semantic patches, but there's still a lot of things to handle manually because I'm touching very, very old code, which is very creative in handling things. And this needs a lot of manual review. To make sure people understand that there's an API change, I want to rename all of the functions. So if there's, I will of course convert all the in-kernel, in-tree users, but if there's out-of-tree users, no. I want them to have their drivers break at build time so they know they need to do something. And this is why if you're used to I2C new dummy, it's now called new dummy device. New secondary device is new ancillary device, new device, new client device, and new probe device I haven't done yet. I will figure out some fancy name. What kind of side effect, what a lot of developers asked me, or not a lot, but quite some, is they want managed versions of these functions. And we only have the new dummy device already, but when cleaning up this with my mass conversion, I could already see, yeah, it removes quite some code handling these new devices. So The other ones will come, so look forward to removing quite some boilerplate code. There's one thing which I also want to tackle while being here is that one thing I never liked about new dummy device, it basically says to that bus, reserve this address. But you never know who requested that. So in the SysFS entry, you also see some addresses blocked, but you have no idea which driver does it or for what reason. And we already had a better function, and I really want to encourage, especially in the future, you to use that, is this new ancillary device, which has a lot of benefits. First, you can be more flexible because you can provide an address in your device tree in case your chip doesn't use the default address. And even if it just has a default address, look at the parameters. We have the client which is requesting the dummy device. Do you know what a dummy device is? Who doesn't? Oh, okay, sorry. There are I2C devices using more than one address. Maybe they have two register sets, or they are talking directly, presenting information from the monitor, or whatever. But still, it's one driver using this multiple addresses. And the old way was you can have only one address per driver. So the dummy devices are used in the driver to say, I need this address too, block it so no one else, especially user space, can access it or mangle with it. It's mine. So you can have one driver like occupying multiple addresses. That's what a dummy device is for. But as I said, you never knew who requested that address. And I really, if you find out that your driver needs that, I'd suggest you use this new function, because then you know who requested it, and you even have a name which gives you roughly an idea what this address is used for. There is no infrastructure yet to present this at runtime. I'm quite unsure if I want to put this into SysFS or DebugFS, but for sure I can tell you I will hook here to present you this kind of information. And I strongly recommend to use that in the future, because if you have a complex driver, then this will make debugging a lot easier, I think. Another API change which recently came, it does not have so much to do with that complex setup I showed to you, is we have now special callbacks for atomic transfers. Because sometimes you want to shut down the system using a PMIC or whatever, some device, and then you need to send an I2C transfer to actually do that, but interrupts are gone by then. And this was never specially handled in the core. It mostly worked by accident. And this was not a very good idea. So we have, if you write a bus master driver, we now have a special callback for that. If it does not exist, it will fall back to the method we had until now, which is like it works by accident. But I strongly suggest if you need that, and the core will print out a warning now. If you try to access it with an interrupts are disabled, it will say, ooh, this is dangerous. I try my very best, but it is dangerous. And if you ever see that warning, you should go into the bus master driver and try to implement an atomic callback which does not use any interrupt, so you can have I2C transmissions very, very late, because I think you want to securely shut down or reboot your machine. We have that, and please make use of that. During all this development, of course, I needed to like create test cases or verify it actually works. And some of the times, I hooked up what I presented 2 years ago, where I described the possibility that you can have GPIOs connected to the same I2C bus under test. And then these GPIOs do crazy things to the bus so that the I2C bus master should get confused or should flag errors or whatever. So special situations you can handle. And I'm seeing I'm running a bit out of time, so I will make it a bit fast. I hope I don't, you can still get it. The first thing which I found out that there was a condition where you could have an unintentional write on the I2C bus if things go wrong. Things go wrong means, in that case, either the bootloader does some I2C and when it's not properly terminated, Linux takes over in the middle of it and then you have an unstable condition on the bus, or the other way around. You have a panic in the Linux kernel in the middle while an I2C transaction is going on, and then you reboot and the bootloader gets an I2C bus which has an inconsistent state. And these fault injectors are there to make it possible to have this inconsistent state. And this one is especially dangerous because it can trigger an unintended write on the bus. It is basically a standard write, as you will see on the scope, except that the last clock cycle is not issued. That means the device is all set up, prepared to do a write, and then left alone. And the bus is in an inconsistent state because the data line is held low by the client because it says, I'm ready for getting a write. There is a technique called bus recovery mentioned in the I2C specification, and we had that implemented in our driver. And that basically means toggle 9 times. That's what was the present state when I was implementing this fault injector. The problem is, the device here gets this missing clock cycle for preparing the write and says, okay, yeah, now I'm ready to write. And then we clock again as the data line is not driven, meaning we basically write to FF somewhere, don't know where. And this is, of course, something you really, 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 really don't want to have. So the solution there was to fix up there is the mechanism in the core to do this toggling. And you see it here, it's just the data line is here it looks a bit more complicated. What we basically do, we send a stop after every toggle to tell the client whatever you've seen, forget about it. So, and to get a consistent state on the bus again. So this is why I really, if you're working on a bus master driver, you really have to get your logic analyzer out and do stuff like this to see if things look proper. My plan is someone to have references on the I2C wiki. So my dream is to have a script which driver authors can use, which triggers some communication. And then on the wiki, you have scopes like this where you can see how it should look like. And then you take your scope and pray that it really looks like this. And if not, you have to do something. But as I said, if you're not paying attention, you can have an unintended write, which was pretty, pretty scary, I think. Another fault injector we have is inject panic, because it waits for some communication to happen by checking the clock line, and then it just interferes with the panic, which is exactly for the situation I mentioned before with the atomic transfers. With that, you can hopefully create a situation where an I2C transaction gets interrupted. And then you can see if your atomic transfer works as expected, or even if that works, if you don't need that, if your bootloader, when it reboots, can handle this inconsistent state on the bus. This is what this fault injector is for. And the last one, I2C is by definition multi-master. It's rarely used, but I see it's more. The usage is increasing. I see that from the mails going to the I2C list. And it's not so easy for bus master drivers to simulate that. So this fault injector basically also, it waits for a communication and then pulls the data line low like another master would do. So your master under test will surely lose the arbitration. And then you can see if the interrupt fires correctly, if your interrupt handler handles this correctly and waits until the bus is free again. I was kind of happy because hardware-wise, getting a true multi-master setup can be a bit of a hassle, but this is super simple. It's really just writing a parameter to this fault injector file, which is the delay or the duration of the interference. How long do you want to keep the line low to simulate the multi-master situation? And then you trigger a transaction to an address which has a lot of ones. The good thing is there doesn't need to be a device responding to it because we're interfering with it anyhow. But you send out a request with lots of ones and we're pulling down the data line to zero and your I2C master should detect there's something wrong. I don't see the address on the bus I was sending out. It doesn't really matter if there's a device listening. And with that, you can also simulate this kind of rare setup, but for a driver, we want that to work because this condition is more and more used, this multi-master setup. Okay, this was my rush through the half an hour I got this day. Like I said, I would have liked to go more into details, but sadly not this year. If you have questions, I think somewhere here, I think we can have 5 minutes of questions if you're not too hungry. We can ask a few right now. Otherwise, I'm here at the conference and my email address, and I think you all know how to reach me if that's needed. So thank you so much so far, and